let's just begin with prayer tonight. How's that? Father, we thank you for tonight, and Lord, we do want to pray for those who are hurting tonight. Lord, you know each individual. And Father, you created us, and Father, when trials and sickness come our way, Lord, I'm thankful that you know all about that. And Father, we do want to bear one another's burdens and certainly uplift those who are hurting. I think of Nina Jean tonight, as we mentioned, and Emma Jean. Lord, we just ask you to just be with them in a very special way. And Lord, I'm thankful that you are, as we sang tonight, you are truly our all in all. Father, you have given us all things that we need that pertain to life and godliness. And Lord, we're just thankful that we are a people who have hope. And Father, I pray tonight, God, I ask that if there be one here who does not have hope tonight, I pray that you would make yourself very real to them. Lord, that they would see that true hope only comes through the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Lord, unless they're a child of God, they truly have no hope. Father, I just pray that for us who are saved, Lord, that you will continue to encourage us, Lord, that we would live our lives in a way that the world might see, as your word says, the hope for the reason that's within us. And Lord, I just ask you just would just use us for your honor and glory tonight. Father, I pray in my own heart and life that there would be nothing there that would hinder me from being used for your honor, for your glory. Father, I know in my heart that I am nothing, and Lord, worthless apart from your grace. And Father, I pray tonight, Lord, that you would speak to us through your word, and we'll give you the glory and praise for it. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Well, if you've been with us this week, we've been going through, this isn't a word, but I guess it's what I'm going to call it. We've been going through, how's this, hopeology, huh? Maybe we can make a doctrinal study in hopeology. But the Word of God has a lot to say about hope. In fact, there's going to be passages that, even in the going through tomorrow night, there's going to be passages that we still won't deal with. You know, you could deal with the subject of hope being one of the Christian virtues that we have. Remember the end of 1 Corinthians 13, right? Now abideth faith. Oh, there it is, right? Hope and love. And the greatest of these is what? Love. And so there's other areas of Scripture where the word hope is mentioned. Hopefully, no pun intended, hopefully we understand that our hope is based in Jesus Christ. This is a theme that we have seen as we went throughout the passages, that Christ is our hope. And oftentimes when we think about hope, as we went through the Scriptures, we've seen that really, I was sharing with Pastor Roger tonight, sometimes it's hard to distinguish between the words faith and hope. I look at one as faith being something present. We walk by faith, not by sight. But then hope certainly has the aspect of a future, even though that I have hope now. And as I think about in the future of that hope of the return of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Scripture is very clear that based upon our hope of the return of Christ, our lives should be different. I often try to, when it comes to the subject of living our lives in a different way, I truly say that I know nobody's personal life here tonight. I know my own, and I know the struggle that I have in my own. One of the things I've always tried in my life, maybe I'm not so good at it. Probably my wife would be the best evaluator, or my kids. But I've always tried to act the same way, no matter where I'm at. Now, I know sometimes when in our family, when we go on vacation, there was always a saying that Dad's in vacation mode. I guess I get a little bit wound up, I guess would be a good way to say it, whenever we're going on vacation. But, you know, when it comes to our walk with Christ, beloved, tonight, my heart is burdened that in my own life, and as well, I hope in your lives, that when people see us, they see a difference. And when I say that, I don't know about you, but I sort of have a cringe when I say that. Because oftentimes, we see a difference in people just because they want to be different. Yeah? You see lots of people who just want to be different sometimes. Yeah, they can be different, all right. Yeah, but there's a difference. And I don't know how to say this without being using the word redundantly, but there's a difference between just wanting to be different and someone who is letting Christ work in and through them no matter where they're at. And I'm thankful. I'm thankful that God has called each of us here tonight. God has called each of us to go different places. And you know, I say this so often, you know, God's going to use you in a different way than which God's going to use me. There's going to be people that you will impact, that you will give hope to, through the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. There will be people that you will be a witness to that I may never have an opportunity to witness to. There may be people drawn to you, maybe at your work, maybe with your personality. Who knows what God uses? But may we live our lives in a way that pleases God so that He can use us no matter where we're at. And I think God wants to do that in our lives. God wants us. Please, we can go back into the Old Testament. God wants us to be different. He wants us to be different. And again, just not to be different. And I think when I say this, you understand what I'm saying. Because I want to make sure I'm clear. Now, let me tell you what God doesn't want. I think we can prove this scripturally. God doesn't want cookie cutters. Right? You know, God doesn't want you to shave your head like mine, right? Amen? You can say amen to that, huh? Yeah? Some of you want to keep what you got, I understand. But God doesn't want cookie cutters. But God does expect us, because we do have a hope, because we have been redeemed, because we have been washed by the blood of the Lamb, to be different. Open your Bibles, if you would, to 1 Peter tonight. And in the first 12 verses of 1 Peter, we covered some of that, some of this Sunday morning, but in the first 12 verses of 1 Peter chapter 1, Peter is giving a great explanation and definition of the great salvation we have in Christ Jesus. In fact, we looked Sunday about that inheritance and how that inheritance is eternal, never going to fade away. And as we see that great salvation described, we come to verse number 13, and that's where I'd like to start tonight. Verse number 13. And I'd like to read verses 13 through 21 tonight. Peter says, "Wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and hope," there's the word, "and hope to the end." Sounds strange, doesn't it? Maybe I could say an endless hope, but that's not what the word is saying, so I won't say it that way. It actually has the idea of a complete hope or a perfected, maybe your translations might even say that better, a perfected hope, and hope to the end, for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ, as obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to the former lusts in your ignorance, but as he which hath called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation, because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. And if ye call on the Father, who without respect of persons judges according to every man's work, pass the time of your sojourning here in fear. Forasmuch as ye know, you were not redeemed with corruptible things, such as silver and gold, from your vain conversation received by the traditions of your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as a lamb without blemish and without spot, who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last days for you, who by him do believe in God, that raised him up from the dead, and gave him glory, that your faith and hope might be in God. Because of the redemption we have in the Lord Jesus Christ, Peter tells us that there ought to be some evidences in our lives because of the hope we have. We've seen it mentioned at the first verse. We see it mentioned at the concluding verse, the word hope. And that hope really centers around the redemption we have in Christ. If you're not saved, you do not have hope. And notice what he begins with. He begins with a preparation of the mind. And it's imperative that we understand how important it is that we prepare our minds. You know, the mind is a powerful agent that God has given us to be used for his glory, or to be abused for sin. You know, the scripture tells us, admonishes us to guard our mind. I believe if there's something that Satan is after, we know that Satan cannot control, cannot unsave us. But I tell you what, there's a lot of things that he can put before the believer that affects our mind. And Peter begins with this preparation. It's a threefold preparation. We see the mind begins. And notice how, excuse me, and notice how he says it. He says, gird up the loins of your mind. Now, and unless you understand girding up the loins, what that means, it would mean something to the people that Peter was writing to, because they would have understood the girding up the loins had the idea of their clothing. And even in the Old Testament times, there were times where Israel was commanded, I think back during the Passover, as they ate the Passover, they were to gird up their loins so that they would be ready to move. And the girding up of the loins, the girding up of their material would be done so it would not impede them from movement. They would be able to move quickly. They would be able to move in the right direction when they're called on to move. It's a matter of being ready. It's a matter of being prepared. And here Peter is making that analogy, but he's not making that analogy to our physical clothing. He's making that analogy to our mind, that we might tie up the loose things of the world and prepare our thinking for the things of Christ. I see this often in the places that I find myself sometimes. Have you noticed, and we know that Scripture tells us this, but have you ever noticed to the pure all things are pure? There's probably not a week goes by that I'll be in a room and something is said and I think nothing about it. I think nothing about what was said. And then I'll see someone on the other side of the room snickering about something. And what they've done is they've taken what was said and they contort it in some perverted way with their mind. And beloved, we need to prepare our minds so that we are not tied up with the things of this world. And when I say with the things of this world, I'm not talking about the material things. I'm talking about the things of this age that has corrupted our thoughts, the things of this fallen system in which we live in that we are bombarded, at least I find myself bombarded with every day. And it's time we take a stand. It's time that we are prepared to speak when opportunity is given. I was eating lunch Monday. I was eating lunch with the commander of the 1092nd up here on the hill. He's not from this area. He lives out in Charleston area somewhere. But I was down in Charleston making up a day of drill on Monday, and I was there. I was eating meal with him, and every once in a while you'll read these emails that'll come out, and it'll say something like this. Don't offend anyone by saying Christmas. Yeah. Not all people are believers. We need to make sure we say holiday. And he had mentioned something about in December that he didn't think his unit had drill. And I said, well, in December, I know you have at least a day of drill because you're going to be at my church here. Not my church, but Pastor Roger, our church. They're going to be at our church here because they like to come to our church and have the Christmas dinner here at the church. And I looked at him and I said, I couldn't help it. I said, and you know what? When you go in the doors, you're going to see something about Christ. And you're going to see something about Christmas. You know? You know, we need to prepare our minds that we understand the things of Christ are way more important than the things of this world. I always think of the hymn, Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. It's a beautiful hymn, isn't it? It changes our perspective as we look upon the things of Christ. And beloved, as we do that, we ought to be different. And again, I'm not saying different to be strange. I'm not saying different to make everything a conspiracy. I'm not saying be different just to act weird. I'm saying to be different because our minds are focused upon the Word of God and it's permeated our thoughts, and the things we think are the thoughts that Christ would have us to think. Not the things that this world wants us to think and dwell upon. That's why Philippians 4:8 is such a powerful verse for the child of God to memorize, to meditate upon those things that bring honor and glory to the Lord Jesus Christ. And Peter begins, because of the hope that is in us, he begins and instructs us to have a preparation of our mind. Wherefore, having put out of the way once and for all everything that would impede us from the free action of our mind, we should strive for the things of Christ. And then we see the second thing in the preparation is, we've come across this word several times this week, but he says, gird up the loins of your mind, and then he says, be sober. Be sober. And it describes one, we've defined it all week this way, I don't see any reason why to define it any different, but we define that as one who is serious about spiritual things. And literally, when we think about sober, don't think about this, when we think about sober, we think, and in a way we can tie to it, we think of free from intoxication, right? Not being controlled by anything other than the Spirit of God. It gives the idea of, the word sober has the idea of someone who is under control. Under control. Now, when I say this, I'm preaching to myself, not you, okay? But sometimes when we're not sober-minded, we allow worry to come into our mind. You ever see someone out of control because they're so worried about something? Yeah, they, oh no, what am I, yeah, you've been around people like that, haven't you? Yeah, sometimes I provoke people like that, but I have to acknowledge, but yeah, oh no, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? You know what, if you're a child of God, you don't have to worry. You don't have to worry. And I know I need to preach to myself as I say this. I know I do. But Peter says, we're to gird up the loins of our mind. We're to be sober. And then notice lastly, he says, in the translation I have here tonight, he says, in hope to the end. The word hope there is the word teleos, and it has the idea to set your hope perfectly, to set your hope unchangeably, without doubt or without being despondent. You know, we have a hope that is complete. We have a hope that is perfect because it's in one who is perfect. And we know that one day he is going to come back again. It's a done deal. It's a done deal because of the resurrection we see of the Lord Jesus Christ. He says, and hope to the end or completely for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. So we see the preparation there as a result of the hope we have or as a result of the redemption we have. Also, the preparation, but also we all need to look at and remember the past. Oftentimes we forget. This might be the opposite side of the mirror as I think about this. We often talk about we ought to be different, right? But then Peter goes on and reminds us, what are we different from? What are we different from before we had the hope that we have? And in this particular passage, he brings up four specific areas. And friends, tonight, as we talk about these four areas, I hope you can say that, yes, this was your past. But because of the hope that's in you, it doesn't exist today. And Peter reminds us, you know, not only to be different, but he remembers what we've been delivered from. Notice, first of all, he says in verse 14, as obedient children, and he begins like this, not fashioning yourself according to the former lusts. The word former lusts has the idea of passionate desires. And before you came to know the Lord Jesus Christ, whether you realize it or not, you were under the control of the desires of your flesh. In fact, before you were saved, you had no desire, you had no power to overcome the desires of your flesh. Oftentimes we look at these former lusts and we look at it in an immoral way, and it can't apply to that. Don't get me wrong. It definitely can't apply to that. Excuse me. And it certainly could apply to that in the time that Peter was addressing the believers in those days. But it's more than just immorality as far as passions and desires. It has the idea maybe for the passionate desires of just the world in general and the things of this world. Thank God we have been delivered from that by the power of the Lord Jesus Christ. And then not only does he talk about the former lusts and of the desires that we had, but notice this, he also brings this up. He says that you not be fashioned yourselves according to the former lusts in your ignorance. Have you ever heard this saying? Fill in the blank. Let him who is ignorant be what? Oh, I gave you one you hadn't heard, huh? Maybe I made it up. Let him who be ignorant be ignorant still. You ever hear someone say that? Good. Don't use that then. Yeah. I've heard people who like to continue in their ignorance. Let him who be ignorant still. You know what? As a child of God, we are no longer ignorant to the Word of God. We have a spiritual understanding because we are saved. I mentioned this the other night, the Apostle Paul in 1 Timothy chapter 1. And I believe it's around verse 12, as he's given testimony to his conversion. He says that he found mercy because what he did in ignorance. Before we were saved, we lived our life in ignorance. 1 Corinthians 2:14, right? The natural man does not understand the things of God. He can't. Neither can he. Because they are what? Spiritually discerned. And I thank God tonight. And as I say that, let me say this. I would be lying right through my teeth tonight if I told you that I understood everything in this book. Let me tell you what. There is so much I do not understand. In fact, have you ever been here? You ever study something to the point of where you're not sure if you understand it at all. Ever been there? And the more you study it, the less you realize, do I really understand this? But I tell you what, I thank God for what I do understand. I thank God that I do understand the gospel. I thank God I do understand that as a child of God, I have hope that this world does not have. And that hope is certainly a message that the world needs to hear today. We have been delivered from this ignorance that we have. Turn here to, go back to John. Here's a good example of that. John chapter 8. John chapter 8. Look with me, if you would, at verse 43. Excuse me. John chapter 8, verse 43. And in the context, I think we, if you read this chapter, you'll understand that Jesus is talking to a religious crowd. He's talking to the Pharisees of the day. And he says in verse 43, why do ye not understand my speech? Why did they not understand? Because they were ignorant. They had no understanding. Why, Jesus said, why do ye not understand my speech? And if Jesus says they didn't understand his speech, they did not understand his speech. Even because ye cannot. Notice the word he uses. Ye cannot hear my word. Ye are of your father, the devil, and the lusts. Again, before we came to know Christ, before we had that hope, the lusts of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning and abode not in the truth, because there was no truth in him. And when he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. And because I tell you the truth, ye believe me not. They could not understand because of their ignorance. Friend, tonight I pray that you can say, I've been delivered from these things. I've been delivered from the former lusts and passions and desires. I've been delivered from the ignorance I had before I came to know the Lord Jesus Christ. And then Peter gives us two other ones. Notice this. And this is where hope really comes into to apply. If you go back with me in 1 Peter Notice what he says here. He says, not fashioning yourself after your former lust and in your ignorance, but as he who hath called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation, because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. And if ye call on the Father, who without respect of person judgeth according to every man's work, pass the time here of your sojourning in fear. For as much as ye know, you were not redeemed with corruptible things, such as silver and gold, from your vain conversation received by the traditions of your fathers. We see two more in verse 18. The first one that we see is your vain conversation. Literally, it means, some of your translations may say a futile life or an aimless life. It basically means this. It means a life without purpose. A life without purpose. Because we have hope. I hope you understand tonight that, please, if you know Jesus Christ as your Savior, please understand this. Your life has a purpose. And I don't know about you. And I'm not going to scream, okay? Although I can when I get excited. I acknowledge that. I get excited when I understand my life has purpose. I enjoy life. I enjoy life. How about you? I enjoy life. You know, today I have a gift that I may not have ever again. No guarantee. But today I got a gift. And I want to make the most of that gift. The gift of today. Before we were saved, before we were redeemed, before we had hope, our life was aimless. We had no goals. We had no hope. And then there's one other thing that we, from in our past, that Peter reminds us, and we see it there toward the end of verse 18, from your vain conversation received by the traditions from your fathers. And the last thing I want you to see that hopefully we've been set apart from because of the hope we have is this, the traditions of men. I am thankful tonight that I do not follow the traditions of men. And I would encourage you in your own heart and in your own life. I'm not telling you not to have convictions. I hope you have convictions. But if you have convictions tonight, I hope you have convictions because they're convictions from the Word of God, not convictions from other men. I know a lot of people that have convictions off of things that I've never found in the Scripture. I'm thankful I've been delivered from the traditions of men. So we see how we're to prepare our minds. We're to see how what we've been delivered from in our past. And then Peter goes on and reminds us of the price of our hope, our redemption. Or excuse me, I missed the whole point. I don't know if I have time to cover this or not. Let me go back. We see the pattern of our hope. Notice verse 15, or verse 14. As obedient children, not fasting yourself according to former lusts of your ignorance, for as he hath called you to be holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation. Again, you will see it written, be ye holy, for I am holy. And we see our pattern that we're to follow as we live this life with hope. That's a pretty high standard, isn't it? Has that passage ever bothered you? That passage in Matthew 5, I mean, when Pastor Rogers, you know, be be perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. Tonight here, we see, be ye holy as your Father is holy. Now, I'm not going to answer for you, but I'm going to answer for myself. I will not reach that standard in this body. I will not. There's no use pretending. I might as well stop now. I will not reach that standard. But let me say this. Please hear me carefully. Just because I won't reach that standard doesn't mean I shouldn't aim for that standard. I am thankful that my God is holy. And this isn't just a New Testament theme. You can go back in the book of Leviticus and see this repeated two or three times throughout the book of Leviticus as God was talking with Israel. And sometimes it was dealing with food and clean food and unclean food. Sometimes it was dealing with the groups of people. But it never changes God's standard. Be holy as I am holy. And that's the pattern of our hope. We ought to seek, we ought to strive to have the holiness of God reflected in our lives. Again, understanding we're not going to be sinless. Amen? We're not going to get there. We will sin. But it doesn't mean I shouldn't strive to be conformed more to the image of my Savior. And then the price of our hope, that redemption for you. That familiar verse, verse 18, for as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things such as silver and gold from your vain conversation, but from the traditions of your father, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish and without spot. You know, as Peter made that statement, he made it very clear, and the people he wrote to in those days would have understood far better than we do the sacrificial system. And as Peter was telling them that our redemption, and we talk about it all the time, you know, salvation is a gift, salvation is free, and it is a gift, and it is free to us, but understand this, it costs God the blood, the death of his own son. Who was, by the way, as Peter reiterates it here, who was sinless? If you remember back in the Old Testament when they sacrificed a lamb, they just didn't sacrifice any lamb, did they? They sacrificed a lamb that was without blemish. I will never understand. I will never understand how God could give the life of his son for me. I'll never understand that. I tell you what, he's here tonight, so I have to be careful what I say. But I harass my son. I probably drive my son crazy. I agitate him. I provoke him wrath a number of times, I'm sure. But I love my son, and I would not give my son for anyone here. I wouldn't do it. And I'd tell him whether he's here or not. I'd tell you that. I wouldn't do it. And yet God gave his son for me. I'll never fathom that. His sinless son. His sinless son. Pastor Rod, one of Pastor Roger's favorite verses, 2 Corinthians 5, 21. He who knew no sin, became sin for us. I'll never understand it. We often say in the military, freedom's not free, because certainly men shed their blood that we might have freedom. When it comes to salvation, Only one person could have given their life that we might be saved. And that was our Savior, Jesus Christ. The price of that was the price that we are redeemed with and the reason we have hope. And there's a purpose for our hope. Understand that this was not some emergency plan by God. This was God's plan before the foundation of the world. Verse 20. Who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifested in these last times for us, for you, who by him do believe in God that raised him from the dead. Hallelujah, right? And gave him glory. For what purpose? Notice it. In order that, or it just says that, means in order that your faith, and not only your faith, but your hope be in God. God who raised Jesus Christ. God who gave his own son. God who is holy. That is the God that my faith and my hope is in. And I am thankful. I am thankful that I can prepare my mind now. I am thankful that I can live my life delivered from the things that he has delivered me from. I'm thankful that I have a pie pattern to aim for, the holiness of God. And I'm so thankful for the sacrifice that paid the price. And that it just wasn't a price to be paid without purpose. That through the resurrection of Christ, our faith and our hope are in him. We sing the song, "On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand." Let's pray. Father, we do thank you tonight for the hope that we have, the hope that's in Christ. Lord, I pray tonight that if there's one here who does not have hope, and they know that, Father, I pray that if they're here without hope tonight, they would settle that issue. May they understand that their hope only comes through Christ. That he paid the price to redeem them through his death, burial, and resurrection. That he paid for our sin. So that we might be free. Free to serve, free to have hope. God, you know my heart. And you know my thoughts. This world is desperate for your hope. Father, we look around the situations, even in the world today, the latest news we hear, and it's obviously people are acting because they were without Christ and without hope. Father, I pray that you would use us in these days for your honor, for your glory. For we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a good evening.